We have Dries to work from Belgium on current Anglo-Saxon political philosophy, liberalism, communitarianism, and populism.
Thank you. So let me begin with two broadly shared convictions regarding the continuing threads in the work of Paul Ricoeur. One is the fact that Ricoeur's philosophy, despite its many faces, can always be seen as a practical philosophy. A philosophy where the questions of the political are never entirely out of sight and often prominently inside. And the second is the fact that Ricoeur rejected, in a way, the boundaries between Anglo-American and continental philosophy, as this is evident in his profound knowledge and use of Anglo-American authors. How about kicking in an open door at this conference? His philosophy bridged the gap in some way by showing how theories from the analytical tradition were essential in the development of his own philosophy, which is hermeneutical, phenomenological, and hence, strictly speaking, continental philosophy. Now, if we combine both commonplaces, it is hardly surprising that Ricoeur had a special interest in Anglo-American political philosophy. He was very familiar with the work of authors such as John Rawls, Michael Walzer, and of course Charles Taylor, whom we will meet the day after tomorrow. And he explicitly engaged with their ideas. Now, these authors are mainly connected to the central debate in Anglo-American political philosophy of the last 40 years, the famous debate between liberals and communitarians. Hence, when Ricoeur engaged with these authors, he also engaged with this debate. And as a consequence, scholars who have written about Ricoeur's encounters with Anglo-American political philosophy have characterized Ricoeur's own philosophy in terms of this debate. In other words, Ricoeur's political philosophy was situated on this liberal communitarian continuum, or at least he was subject to a search for liberal and communitarian elements in his thought, with an analysis of how he combined both into a theory that transcends the contradiction between both sides. In this paper, I will look at this common way of evaluating Ricoeur's dialogue with Anglo-American political philosophy, but only in order to complement it with a confrontation of Ricoeur and a branch of Anglo-American political philosophy that goes beyond the liberal communitarian debate. And this other branch is neo-republicanism, as it became prominent in the last two decades, I would say. The aim of this paper is to show how a confrontation of Ricoeur's political philosophy with this neo-republicanism tells us more than the identification of his work in terms of liberalism and communitarianism. It tells us more on the nature of Ricoeur's own political philosophy, and it tells us more on how Ricoeur's ideas still have a valuable input in contemporary Anglo-American political philosophical debate. So, as I have said, it is good to start with the common characterization of Ricoeur's interaction with Anglo-American political philosophy in terms of liberalism and communitarianism. For that purpose, I will take an important author on the subject as example, which is Bernard Dauenhauer. Dauenhauer was probably the first to publish a full-scale presentation of Ricoeur's political thought in the book Paul Ricoeur, The Promise and Risk of Politics, from 1998. But in this matter, I will rely mostly on a shorter essay from 2010 entitled Ricoeur and Political Theory, Liberalism and Communitarianism. Dauenhauer describes Ricoeur's political philosophy paradoxically as communitarian liberalism. He argues that Ricoeur's political philosophy is based on a conception of personhood that combines the advantages of both liberalism and communitarianism without their respective disadvantages. Whereas liberalism ensures the recognition of individual autonomy, it does so on the basis of strongly individualist presuppositions. These individualist presuppositions are in danger of making liberalism self-subverting, because the impulses against anything that interferes with individual freedom threaten the stability of the very system that is supposed to protect individual rights. Communitarianism, on the other hand, acknowledges our dependence on the communities that constitute our identity, and hence it requires politics to protect and promote those communities. But communitarian politics runs the risk of forcing people into frameworks they reject. Referring to terms used by Michael Walzer, Dauenhauer identifies this as dangerous associative impulses of communitarianism as opposed to the dangerous dissociative impulses of liberalism. He goes on to argue that Ricoeur can be called a communitarian liberal on the basis of his conception of personal identity. As we know, this conception rests on the distinction between idem identity, which is the collection of empirical dispositions that constitute one's spatiotemporal sameness, and ipse identity, which is the self-constancy that underlies the capacity to make and keep promises, and hence to be held accountable for one's actions. Ricoeur describes personal identity as a narrative identity that combines idem and ipse identity in a way that gives expression to both human indebtedness and the power to initiate novelty. This conception of the human person honors the liberal focus on the self as a unique individual, in the sense that Ricoeur rejects the existence of agents of higher order than the individual. Every action can be attributed and imputed to an agent as an individual act. Hence, every individual has to be able to dissociate himself from any group or institution that would endanger his capacity for initiative. But Ricoeur also honors the communitarian focus, the focus on the fact that human action is dependent on communal resources. The recognition of the fact that communal resources are constitutive of one's idem identity results in the necessary associative impulses. The core of what Dauenhauer calls Ricoeur's communitarian liberalism is the idea that every individual citizen has will-independent duties with regard to society, including an obligation to commit oneself to the preservation of the communal framework for others, with the important proviso that these obligations are a matter of critical loyalty. With this very brief example, it is clear that the common way of framing the confrontation of Ricoeur with Anglo-American political philosophy is in terms of liberalism and communitarianism. Ricoeur is named a communitarian liberal, in some respects a liberal, in some respects a communitarian, but more importantly, not a real liberal, neither a real communitarian. So the identification is mostly negative. Actually, if we characterize Ricoeur in terms of liberalism and communitarianism, we are not able to say very much. Saying that Ricoeur is a communitarian liberal is actually like saying Ricoeur is Ricoeur. You know, he takes both sides and uses them both in his own view. However, I think we can say more about Ricoeur in terms of Anglo-American political philosophy if we take a broader look at Anglo-American political philosophy itself. Because this liberal communitarian debate is not the entire story. During the 90s, the stalemate in the dilemma between the individual and the community gave rise to a new focus with the ambition to resolve the dispute. I'm talking about the focus on the issue of citizenship. It is this focus that facilitated the revival of republicanism in Anglo-American political philosophy, with important authors such as Quentin Skinner, Philip Pettit, and Michael Sandel. Republicanism is a political philosophy at least as old as the Roman Republic, and it was the dominant theory of liberty in Europe until the 18th century, when liberalism began to take up the baton. The contemporary neo-republicanism takes up the core ideas of this ancient theory. Philip Pettit sums up these core ideas as a threefold concern. The first is a conception of freedom as non-domination. The second is the idea of a mixed constitution. And the third is the importance of a vigilant citizenry. Let us have a look at these core ideas. The most important is the conception of freedom as non-domination. This conception contains a double criticism regarding the liberal conception of freedom as non-interference. First, republicanism claims that not every interference is an infringement on liberty. We may have taken part in the realization of this interference as an expression of power in common, for example, within a just democratic decision procedure. In that case, there is no domination and hence no infringement on liberty. Second, the liberal conception of freedom is not only too encompassing, but in another sense also too narrow. Domination does not necessarily require actual interference. The Saudi woman who doesn't drive a car because she's scared of traffic is not unfree in the liberal interpretation. This freedom, however, is dependent on the alignment of her will with the ruling power. If she changes her mind and wants to drive, then she suddenly does become unfree, without having any influence on the rule that inflicts these restrictions on her. So, although not interfered with yet, the woman is subject to a dominating power, which may inflict arbitrary restrictions. Therefore, she is not free. In light of this republican conception of liberty, individual liberty is essentially linked to the liberty of the political community. A free individual requires a political community without arbitrary domination. And the other two core ideas ensue from this. A political community without arbitrary domination requires a mixed constitution, which is a constitution that sufficiently restricts those in power, and a vigilant citizenry, a citizenry on the lookout for transgressions of the authorities and willing to act against any such transgression. My claim is that, although Ricoeur never identified himself explicitly in terms of republicanism, the same republican idea is at the core of his political philosophy. And by the way, the fact that Ricoeur did not identify himself in terms of this republicanism should not be surprising. The revival of republicanism is perhaps too recent to have caught his attention, but more importantly, republicanism has a different meaning in the French context than it has for Anglo-American neo-republicanism. French republicanism is more about popular sovereignty and national self-determination, which is rather incompatible with the emphasis on mixed constitution and contestatory citizenship in Anglo-American neo-republicanism. That being said, we can now identify a distinctively neo-republican, so not French republican, but neo-republican current in Ricoeur's political philosophy. The main idea in Ricoeur's political thought is the idea of the political paradox. This is something that was again emphasized in the recent book Ricoeur Politique by Pierre-Olivier Monté. The political paradox is the following, and I quote the description from Bernard Dallenhauer. Political practice displays progress in rationality insofar as it has developed a constitution that declares the fundamental equality of all the society's members before the law. And it organizes the people so that they can make decisions together and achieve a historical efficacy that would otherwise not be possible. But politics also always involves the ruling or domination of some by others. This ineliminable domination always tempts those who would rule to make ever greater impositions upon the ruled. End of quote. Although this is perhaps not evident on first sight, this paradox implies the three core ideas of republicanism. First, it is important to see that the political paradox, and hence Ricoeur's political thought in general, is about freedom. In the words of Ricoeur, whether the state founds freedom by means of its rationality, or whether freedom limits the passions of power through its resistance. Now, the important question in this regard is, of course, what conception of freedom? Ricoeur gives a very clear statement of his conception of freedom in a commentary entitled Le paradoxe de la liberté politique from 1959. There he explains the paradoxical relation between political power and freedom. Politics is essentially about the realization of freedom. The Constitution realizes, through the horizontal relation of power in common, equal liberty and fundamental rights, but at the same time, it establishes the vertical relation of power over, which tends towards illegitimate violence towards our autonomy. Ricoeur concludes that real political freedom consists in the elimination of the alienation at the dark side of political power. Freedom is the absence of illegitimate, arbitrary power over. In other words, and in fact in Republican words, we can say that Ricoeur's conception of freedom is freedom as non-domination. This means that government should not only be government of the people and government for the people, but also government by the people. The paradox itself makes this never fully realizable, but the ambition should be to come as close as possible to non-domination by means of both checks on political power, which is the freedom of contestation, and participation in the exercise of power itself, which is the freedom of participation. So he distinguishes both these expressions of freedom, freedom of contestation, freedom of participation. This brings us to the other two elements. In response to the political paradox, the question is how to realize this freedom of freedom as non-domination. Ricoeur underlines that the conclusion of the paradoxical nature of politics should not be defaitism. It is rather supposed to give rise to a vigilant and active citizenry. Given the fact that political power faces man with opportunity as well as risk, the conclusion is that every citizen has a duty to enact political vigilance and the willingness to move from critical reflection to action. Following a distinction by Max Weber, which Ricoeur uses in his own particular way, Ricoeur then stresses that the corresponding civic virtue is not an absolute ethics of conviction that follows an ideal in a manner blind to the consequences of power in the real world. It is an ethics of responsibility, which stands for reasonable, prudent political action, aware of the dangers of the paradoxical nature of power, without ever losing the ideal out of sight. This idea of vigilant citizenship was very important in Ricoeur's political writings in the 50s and 60s, but it came again to the fore in The Just and some other later essays. There he takes a look at the debate between liberals and communitarians from the perspective of his little ethics, and more specifically from the recognition that action always involves interaction and that self-esteem is full only if it is the counterpart of solicitude for others. It is this engagement of Ricoeur with liberalism and communitarianism that gave rise to authors like Dauenhauer, but also David Kaplan, Johan Michel, to characterize Ricoeur in liberal and communitarian terms. But in fact, he engages liberalism and communitarianism, but in distinct republican terms. He rejects the liberal claim that civic duties are merely conditional, since our capacity to act can only be meaningful in the institutional context of a given community. This positive conception of freedom, whereby human fulfillment requires institutional mediation, implies the duty to preserve these institutions for oneself and others. Ricoeur connects this statement with the Hegelian concept of recognition, which is a mutual relationship between the political institutions and the individual. On one hand, political institutions that recognize individual autonomy are a necessary condition for the person to flourish. On the other hand, the person must recognize his debt with regard to the political institutions. This is something that you will talk about, given the title of your paper. The difference with liberal individualism is clear. I quote, "If individuals consider themselves the bearers of certain rights, they will tend to take mutual association and the obligations that follow from it to be a mere means for obtaining security in whose shelter they may pursue their own individual ends. And they may consider their participation as conditional and revocable. But if, on the contrary, they see themselves as indebted from birth to certain institutions which have allowed them to become free agents, they will feel themselves obligated as regards these institutions, obligated in particular to make these institutions accessible to others." End of quote. As a result, the ethical aim to live the good life with and for others in just institutions implies the political responsibility for the institutional framework of the historical community. The person as a citizen has the responsibility to participate in the care for the just exercise of political power, the responsibility to limit illegitimate domination, in order that the institutional precondition for meaningful autonomy does not at the same time violate our autonomy. Ricoeur illustrates this need through a discussion of the debate between the liberalism of Rawls on the one hand and the communitarianism of Walzer on the other hand. And there he stresses the paradoxical status of the political sphere and the implied danger of the transgression of politics into other spheres. So it comes down to this: the political is about power over and power in common. And it is the task of democracy that to ensure that power over is under the control of power in common. And it is the task of the citizen to do his share in this task of democracy. This brings us to the third core idea of republicanism, the idea of a mixed constitution, which is also present in Ricoeur's inferences from the political paradox. The institutional framework of democracy has to be such that a vigilant citizenry is capable of having an adequate influence. And it should also guarantee the necessary automatic checks and balances within the system itself, not leaving the power in single hands. The Constitution has to establish institutional techniques that make the exercise of power possible, but the abuse of power impossible. In the words of Ricoeur himself, que l'État soit et qu'il ne soit pas trop. The idea of a mixed constitution is all about the separation, the cooperation, and the balance, the balancing of powers. These elements are crucial in Ricoeur's institutional response to the political paradox. They are especially visible in his reaction in the journal Esprit during the 50s to communist totalitarianism in both the Soviet Union and in China. His plea for political liberty was made concrete in, among other things, a call for independent judicial power, freedom of information instead of a monopoly of truth for the authorities, and also things like free labor unions and the right to strike. A clear model, an elaborated model, to bring the idea of a mixed constitution to actualization is, to my knowledge, not to be found in the work of Paul Ricoeur, but the fact that he endorsed the idea is clear, even from the very beginning of his career. In an article from 1947 entitled La crise de la démocratie et de la conscience chrétienne, he already underlined the need for constitutional provisions that protect every citizen from both anarchy and despotism. And this conviction remained as vital in his later political thought, and particularly in light of the concern for just institutions. There he continues to argue that constitutional restrictions on power over are extremely important, even though the Constitution is in the first place a matter of establishing power in common. This is especially prominent in his discussion of Walzer and the issue of the self-limitation of the political sphere. There he explicitly mentioned how this issue calls into question the French kind of republicanism. This French kind of republican thought centered on undivided popular sovereignty. Now, the reason why he does not argue more specifically for a particular model of mixed constitution is to be found probably in the fact that he emphasizes the historical and hence imperfect and necessarily open character of any institutional arrangement, but also in his resistance towards proceduralism, as this is evident in his critique of Rawls. Now, it should be clear that the core ideas of neo-republicanism, and especially these ideas of freedom as non-domination and vigilant citizenship, are as essential in Ricoeur's political philosophy. However, this does not imply that there are no important differences. We might say that Ricoeur is a republican in the Anglo-American sense, but he definitely differs from the two known branches of neo-republicanism, and this in a quite a significant manner. These regular branches, I might say, of neo-republicanism are civic republicanism on the one hand and civic humanism on the other hand, or in another terminology, a Neo-Roman and a Neo-Athenian variant. The most important contemporary civic republicanists are Quentin Skinner and Philip Pettit. Civic republicanism, or Neo-Roman republicanism, conceives of civic duties from the perspective of freedom as non-domination. Self-government, in an active manner, is a necessary countermeasure against domination. So far, Ricoeur agrees. But this freedom as non-domination should be interpreted in light of Berlin's two concepts of liberty, either as an enlarged negative conception of freedom as non-interference, which is the case for Skinner, or as a distinct third conception of liberty, which is the case for Pettit. In either way, civic republicanism is opposed to any positive conception of freedom. And this, while Ricoeur's conception of freedom is definitely a positive conception. Departing from the ethical orientation in all human action towards living the good life winning for others in just institutions, Ricoeur's concept of liberty stresses the priority of responsibility over autonomy. The resulting theoretical view on citizenship is that civic duties should primarily be conceived from an ethical perspective. The task of the citizen is not fundamentally different from the ethical task of the person. The political task of the person as a citizen is a particular aspect of the realization of the ethical aspiration. It concerns or reaches beyond the interpersonal level to the third person, the person we will probably never meet in person, but nevertheless have an institutional relationship with. In politics, as well as in ethics, the task is to attain critical solicitude or to act out of care for the realization of the ethical aim to live well with and for others in just institutions. And this in a way that is conscious of both universal norms and real-life situations. So Ricoeur basically rejects the individualistic presuppositions of civic republicanism. And this is a good thing, since these individualistic presuppositions make civic republicanism vulnerable to the communitarian criticism of liberalism. And this makes civic republicanism even more self-subverting than liberalism, because it essentially relies on civic virtue, while these neo-republicanists, or at least civic republicanists, provide no ethical or anthropological support for these virtues. And this given their individualistic outlook. So we can already see that Ricoeur transcends civic republicanism. Given his positive conception of liberty, Ricoeur seems closer to civic humanism. The main contemporary proponent of civic humanism, or Neo-Athenian republicanism, as it is also called, is Michael Sandel. Further back in time, Hannah Arendt could be categorized likewise. Civic humanism distinguishes itself from civic republicanism precisely because it builds upon a positive conception of liberty. It states that self-government, which requires an active citizenship, is an intrinsically valuable, necessary, and primary prerequisite for the fulfillment of human life. Ricoeur then conceives of civic duties from the perspective of the freedom to establish the good life with and for others in just institutions. Although this implies a positive conception of freedom as well, it significantly differs from the positive freedom of civic humanism. In Ricoeur's view, self-government is not an intrinsic good, but it is a necessary precondition for the pursuit of the ethical goal, taking into account this proneness of politics towards illegitimate domination. This difference becomes most apparent in his criticism of both Aristotle and Arendt. He claims that they both underestimate the fact that politics has a dark side, which is something he emphasizes in his political paradox. His plea for active citizenship is not based on the direct contribution of political action to an accomplished human life, but it is based on this paradoxical nature of politics. With regard to active citizenship, it is a negative argument that dominates. Dominates is perhaps not the most perfectly chosen word. So this keeps Ricoeur far away from the positive conception of politics that characterizes civic humanism. Political activity is necessary to limit the violence that politics necessarily entails and that endangers the pursuit of the ethical aim. That is the reason why only self-government equals freedom. I come to my conclusion. It would be exaggerated to call Ricoeur a neo-republicanist. The main reason for this is that Ricoeur's political philosophy is not a systematized philosophy. Although he shares these core ideas, his political philosophy is not a republican system, such as these Anglo-American republican theories. But the comparison is useful for a number of reasons. First, the confrontation with republicanism is useful to highlight continuities in Ricoeur's political thought. These continuities concerning the importance of the political paradox, the importance of a conception of freedom as non-domination, and the importance of vigilant citizenry. Second, when we want to situate Ricoeur with regard to Anglo-American political philosophy, the comparison with republicanism brings us further in the direction of a positive identification than a confrontation in merely liberal communitarian terms. And third, the connection between Ricoeur and republicanism shows more clearly how Ricoeur's philosophy can provide a valuable input in Anglo-American political philosophy, in the contemporary debates there, with his reflections that are very sympathetic towards republicanism, while his thought also uncovers essential flaws in both civic republicanism and civic humanism. So I can conclude that those Anglo-American republican authors should definitely start reading Ricoeur. Thank you for listening.
Questions?
Yes. As an opponent of Rawls, and you said you described his opposition in terms of an opposition to proceduralism. And from my understanding of Ricoeur's criticism of Rawls, it seems to be, in typical Ricoeurian fashion, a matter more of limiting proceduralism. So,
yeah.
You know, the title of the essay is a pure proceduralism possible,
yeah.
And he has obviously a negative conclusion. So, I wonder whether characterizing Ricoeur as a Republican or neo-Republican in the way you have, whether it does fully do justice to the procedural and liberal aspects of his thought.
Well, I don't think they are. There's a contradiction there. I don't think that the. You are totally right in saying that this criticism of Rawls is not a criticism to proceduralism as such, but to an unlimited use of proceduralism. But in this neo-republicanism, proceduralism is not excluded. Definitely not. But I think it is.
It seems though that what you're calling the neo-Roman model is more amenable to a procedural aspect than.
The that is definitely true. But. Definitely. When you look at Philip Pettit, there's a strong proceduralist tendency in his work. But then again, just the fact that he also differs from the civic republicanist branch shows how this procedural outlook has its place within a republican view, as we can find it in Ricoeur, but it's not the entire story, and it should be complemented by an ethical perspective, basically. And this is something that brings him closer to civic humanism. But then again, there's also the other side. So.
I guess then the sort of either or is either positive freedom, wherein politics and ethics are close to the line, or some degree of proceduralism. It seems like the Neo-Athenian model you're describing doesn't have a lot of place for procedural aspect.
Yes, certainly less. I wouldn't say it's Well, Arendt, I don't know very well. Given your paper, you know her much better. But definitely also in Sandel, it's not that procedural concerns are entirely out of the question there, but they have a much lesser importance.
I guess what I'm asking is it the case that the closer you align politics and ethics, does it seem to you that the closer you align politics and ethics, the less easy it is to have a sort of blind proceduralism?
Yes, yeah, definitely. Yes,
so
because
in other words, proceduralism isn't an ethical claim.
Well, in the way Rawls uses it, and in this purely purely proceduralistic outlook, I think Ricoeur has definitely a good point in criticizing the fact that this makes it difficult to relate the issue of justice to an ethical source.
Yeah, I agree with you.
Other questions?
How to make people be vigilant that the people need to be educated by whom, and does the philosopher have a duty to enlighten the people?
Well, definitely. This is something really important in the work of Ricoeur, his idea of political education. The fact that, first of all, people need to be aware of this political paradox itself. So this requires education in itself. And then again, there's also the more practical outlook of how to make people capable of using their freedom of contestation and freedom of participation. And of course, how to bring this into practice is a very difficult question, and a question that Ricoeur, well, did not elaborate on very amply. But it's a big concern for him, definitely. And of course, in this regard, this is, of course, very important in neo-republicanism as well. And there, well, for example, Philip Pettit brings to mind that it is important to see that this vigilant citizenship should not be seen as a kind of general attitude that has to be present in every individual citizen. Also in this political responsibility of every individual, of every citizen, there can be a kind of division of labor where one can follow one's own interests, one's own passions, and this makes a kind of aggregate result of a vigilant citizenry. This does not entirely answer the question in Ricoeur's view, because of course There's this difficulty of relying on the aggregate result of individual action or action, political action on account of individual interests, which is in fact the difficulty with civic republicanism, and which he criticizes in the fact that we need a kind of ethical outlook from the beginning of our looking at justice. So it's difficult to have a good answer in a practical way to this question, but it's something we should look into, which is of course a bit of a sad answer to your question. I'm sorry.
I would say that if each is aware of what is said, then it is up to each to do what he or she wants, or decide what he or she wants.
I'm sorry, can you repeat your question?
If each of us, if each one is aware of what is given in the form of information, mm-hmm. then each one can decide how and or what wants done from that point. No?
I don't see the question in your. Is it a remark or? Oh yeah, okay.
Some kind of response. Oui, je rebondis sur la question de.
Ah oui, okay.
Je me dis, je suis hors du... Je veux dire que si tant est que, si tant est qu'on sait ce qu'il y a comme idée, c'est à chacun de retenir ce qu'il veut parmi les idées.
Oui. C'est vrai, mais de l'autre côté, c'est difficile à combiner cela avec le devoir.
En toute liberté.
Oui, ben. But it's definitely a very difficult issue when you try to put it into practice, which is perhaps the big flaw of the Republican answer to the liberal communitarian debate as such.
Sure, it's sort of a follow up on the question of education and vigilance. What it's a pertains to the normative. What role does or is there a role for the virtues, given that it's Neo-Athenian? And if there is a role for the virtues, how is there a process of determining which virtues should be prominent in one's education?
Yeah, very good question.
Because let me just put it in the context of the question of proceduralism, because you could say that there's a virtue called something aligned with instrumentality and efficiency, neutrality, which would lend itself towards proceduralism or discussing proceduralism. So there must be some virtues that are friendlier to the Neo-Athenian type republicanism and the kinds of public discourse and engagement it has.
Yes, well, but then of course it is... I think, yeah, this is, of course, of essential importance. But we cannot rely solely on these virtues that are more likely to combine with procedural concerns, because then the problem is that then again we would lapse into the problem of founding these virtues. Where are the virtues founded on? That is, of course, the crucial concern. We cannot rely on virtues without showing how these virtues are based on anthropological and ethical concerns, ethical foundations. And when you rely solely on these kind of virtues that are likely to combine with proceduralism, it's a general answer, I'm afraid. But then I think the problem is that it would not be enough to really press the issue of civic humanism.
Okay.
I don't know whether that's
it. Well, we can talk about it more later, but it's
interesting. Yeah, I think we do need to move on. Well, let's thank Therese for the very thoughtful presentation.